Praise the Lord, saints. Don't be caught with your work undone. She's talking about prayer. Prayer is work too. Prayer is laboring for the Lord too. Samuel, he told Israel when they were messing up, he says, heaven forbid that I should sin against the Lord by not praying for you. Amen. And when you pray and you do the work for the Lord, you got to give him your all. Because 99 and a half just won't do. Keep it locked right here on the Crown Gem of Cleveland, Ohio. Again, I'm your host, Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. Selah.
Psalm 16, Miktam of David. Preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. Their sorrow shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. The Lord is the portion of mine inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord, who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt shew me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Chapter 22.
May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and especially the doers of his word, in case you just clicked in. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate. I'm with Royal Diadem Internet Ministry, and we're going to be talking about Psalms chapter 16, and then we're going to switch over to 1 Kings, the 22nd chapter. Because when I left off, I was talking about gods with a little g. And we started out with bowls. Because bowls symbolizes either two things, blessing or cursing. Your bowl can be filled with good things, or your bowl can be filled with bad things. In Revelation, it talks about the seven bowls of wrath. In other words, in that container is God's wrath. And he pours it out. And why does he pour it out? Because of disobedience from his people. He pours it out against his enemies. He says, if you love me, you keep my commandments. If you really love God, then you're going to be obedient to him. Because a lot of people want to hear about God's wrath. They want to hear about God's love. But they want to do what they want to do. And anytime you're in a relationship, in any type of relationship, there's a responsibility that you have to play too. One part is that you love back. They love you and you love them back. They give to you and you give back. One of the reasons why there's such a high divorce rate is because there is self-centeredness in a lot of relationships. One person wants you to be everything that they need, but they're not willing to be everything that you need. Okay? There has to be a meeting and a coming together of the minds and hearts in any kind of relationship. There has to be compromise. I told you that the Word of God said in Psalm 16, he says, Michum, first of all, let me say Michum means unknown. Now, I don't understand why it says the Michum of David, the unknown of David. I don't understand what that means right now. I've been looking that up. I'm still looking it up. And I'm not going to sit up here and pretend that I know everything, because there's some things I come across in the Bible that I quite don't understand. But what we're going to do is we're going to pray together. And God's going to either give me the understanding or give you the understanding and then put it on my Facebook. That's Facebook.com, Deborah Tate, or you can Twitter me, Pastor Deborah Tate, or you can Google me, Pastor Deborah Tate, okay? But in Psalm chapter 16, he says this, David says this, preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. O my soul that has said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellence in whom is all my delight. Okay, in other words, the saints in the earth, their excellence, how they want to serve God is God's delight. And it's also David's delight. And I told you last week, there's nothing better. I know for me, I have one friend. I hope she don't mind me saying her name, Gwen. She's a born-again Christian, and we've been friends for 30 years. And the 30 years, she's been a delight. Her and Jeffrey have been a delight. That's her husband. They have been a delight to me. There's nothing I won't do for them. They're always a delight. Even when we have disagreements, it's still delightful. Amen, amen. Verse 4, their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another god. Okay, and I told you, gods with the little g always means demons. One of the things that really bothers me is when I read Genesis, you know, in chapter 3, where Satan is talking to, well, we know the serpent is talking to Eve. We know that's Satan. He's talking to Eve, and he says, God knows, in other words, he's calling God a liar. He's saying, God knows that the day that you partake of this fruit, you will be as wise as gods. And some are wise as God. And some translation put a capital G-O-D. And some translations put it little G-O-D. And I think Satan was saying, the day that you partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you're going to be like us. It's pretty, I think, is what he was telling her. But she didn't quite understand. She didn't quite comprehend, okay? What she should have did was just trust in faith that God said, do not partake of that tree. And what happened was, when we partook, and I say we because we were in the loins of Adam and Eve, when we partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, then I noticed good is always on the same tree with evil. I believe we became like gods with the little g, knowing the difference between knowledge, knowing the difference, the knowledge of good and evil, knowing the two differences. And the reason I say that, because up until that time, Adam and Eve were innocent. I don't believe that they really knew what evil was all about until they disobeyed God. And when they disobeyed God, that was evil. And then evil came rushing in. And then evil ended up in our family line, in our bloodline. And this is why we need a new bloodline, Jesus Christ. This is why it's important to understand the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and why he died and why he gave his life for us. But the saints that are in the earth, he says, and to the excellence in whom is all my delight, their sorrow shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. And that's what they did. That's what Adam and Eve did. They hastened after another God because they listened. Because he's told them, he says, if you eat this, he said, you will be like God with the little g. But like I said, one of the things that upset me is some of the translations of some of these Bibles that are coming out now. We got a whole bunch of different translations now. Me, myself, personally, I stick with the King James Version. If I do use another Bible, I use it like a commentary to try to help you to understand what that portion of Scripture mean. But myself, personally, I'm a King James Version person. Okay? So he says, and he says this. He says, their sorrows shall be, we're still on verse 4 of Psalms chapter 16. He says, their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offering, and what is drink? Drink is in a what? It's in a cup. It's in a cup, it's in a bowl. A cup is just another name for a bowl. A cup is a bowl is a cup. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. And then he says this in verse 5, which I find to be very profound, and it's in line with what we're talking about. The Lord is the portion of my inheritance and of my cup. In other words, he wants his cup to be filled up with the inheritance of the Lord. See, one of the other things that I find that's strange in the body of Christ and in the church is that we talk so much about natural inheritance that rots and decay. We talk about leaving our kids money and leaving our kids things and leaving our kids cars and clothes. We talk about those type of inheritance. We talk about God giving us stuff. Stuff that will decay. We spend a lot of time on our knees praying for things that are going to rot and decay. I think we need to do like my girl says, we need to pray while yet there's still time. We got to work while yet there's still time. Okay, that's the song that I played. If you were listening, the song that I played earlier. We have to work while it's still time, while it's still day. She's talking about prayer. Because a lot of people spend a lot of time praying for things when they should be praying for souls. Because there's a lot of effort in souls. But you know why I think they pray for things? Because it's easier to get things. It's easier to see those prayers answered than it is to see a person saved. Because when you're praying, you and God is trying to get that person's soul, that person's mind, to come to a saving knowledge of who Jesus is. And sometimes that's not easy. It's not easy because they have their own will. They make their own decisions. And so we find ourselves really having to pray. It's not that simple. Where things, it's easier to ask God for things and see them manifest because you're not fighting against somebody's will, okay? But when you're praying for souls, those are hard prayers to get answered because you're dealing with people and they're constantly changing their mind. They're constantly doing things and they're thinking and they have their own will where a car doesn't. Okay, you can ask God, God, I need a car. God can give you that. That car can't say, okay, I don't want to go. But a person, you say, Lord, I want to see my sister, my mother, my father, my brother. I want to see all of them saved. And God starts working on it, and they say no. Or they do something to slow down the process, or they take a step backwards. Have you ever seen people who look like, you know, God was doing something with them? I know I've seen that. God would be doing something with them. And everybody's getting happy. Oh, they're finally coming around to a saving knowledge of who Jesus Christ is. And then the next minute, you know, they done turned around and went totally 100% back in the opposite direction. And then you have to get on your knees and you have to pray again. Amen, amen. He says this. He says the Lord in verse 5 of Psalms chapter 16. He said, the Lord is the portion of my inheritance and of my cup. He wants to fill his cup up with the inheritance of the Lord. He wants his cup to be full of the Holy Ghost. He wants his cup to be full of love. He wants his cup to be full of peace. He wants his cup to be full. He said, thou maintainest my lot. But those that hasten after other gods, he said, their sorrow shall be multiplied. And we talked about that last week. I talked about bowls. And I talked about how sorrow, how wrath can be saved up in our bowls. And how those things can be poured out on us. Or as the Lord say in the Bible, he says, tell them. He tells the prophet, tell them their cup of iniquity has overflowed now. He's talking about their bowls. He's talking about that sorrows shall be multiplied because they have chosen the wrong way to go. And any time you choose Satan, and it starts all the way back to the Garden of Eden, any time you start choosing the God with the little g, there's going to be sorrow. What happened? Woman ended up in pain during childbirth. All through her life, a woman has pain. Her children gives her lots of pain. Lots of pain does a mother experience raising her children. Comes with pleasure, but there's also some pain. The man has to work all the days of his life. Now women have to work all the days of their life because some men don't want to assume the responsibility of their children until they're grown. Then all of a sudden they show up in the picture and say, here I am. Well, where were you years ago? Oh, you was playing games. You were pretending to have a deadly disease. You're pretending, I'm going to do the right. No, you didn't want the responsibility of that child. Now that child is grown and now all of a sudden here you are. You want the responsibility of that child. But before, you didn't want it. You was doing everything you could think of to get out of the responsibility. And then you want to pass it on, pass the buck on. Hasten after the multitudes. Hasten after other gods. That's what they're doing. But the psalmist says the place, he says he places his confidence in God's ability to provide for him. That's what it is. He says, my inheritance. He's letting you know God is the inheritance of my cup. I told you that not only was the psalmist pleased with God, he was pleased with God's people. And we don't hear that today being said. In the King James Version 3:16, he speaks of this, the excellence that he has in knowing who God is. In other words, he's extremely satisfied. He's extremely satisfied. Has extreme pleasure being around other saints. True saints, I told you last week, are God's faithful people. And then when you're around true saints of God, you'll find that it can be one of the most pleasurable experience ever. True saints, and there are true saints. God does not leave himself without a remnant. There is a people that are serving God. I've met them. There is for every bad pastor, there's one good pastor that's really out here not for your money, but really love the Lord. I've met them too. I'm able at this point in my life to tell who is called and who is not called. You can tell by if they're growth. If they're not growing, then that's not of God. Because whoever's that's feeding God's people, because remember, God is our shepherd. We shall not want. He leadeth us. He leadeth us to green pastures. God is going to lead you to that good person, that good pastor. If you're really trying to live for the Lord, God is going to send you to a good pastor. Now, I'm not going to say a couple of counterfeits won't get in there, but he will give you discernment and let you know this person is not right. And I've met a lot of pastors that weren't right. I mean, a lot of them. But I've also met some that really, truly love the Lord. And I've known them for years. And they're still walking with God. And they're still talking about the Lord. And they're still being sincere. And their cup is full of the inheritance of God. And to me, that's a good morning cup of word. True saints are constantly pouring forth from their cup the word of God. Within their human cups. We are human cups. We are containers. That's why it's so important to watch what you watch on TV, to watch what you listen to on the radio. Because when you're filling your cup up, your cup is you. You're a plastic, not plastic, well, yeah, you are an earthly container because everything comes from the earth. You're an earthly container. And it's important what you fill yourself up with. If you fill yourself up with a lot of cussing and profanity and hate and gossip and slander, that is what's going to come out of your mouth. There's always going to be some drama. I stay away from those people, including family members. When I see they're slandering and gossiping and bringing one another down, that's in and out of the church and family, I get away from them. But how do they get that way? Not being careful about what they watch on TV, not being careful of the music that they listen to, the people that they associate with. Because unless they're associating with people that know Jesus, they're not associating with very good people. And they're filling up their cup with some ungodly stuff. And they're running after gods with the little g. And all that's going to bring is misery. And I stay away from them. I let them go. True saints will not entertain other gods with a little g. What does it mean when I say gods with a little g? I'm talking about demons that are controlling people in the natural realm. They're in the spiritual realm, but what they're doing in the spiritual realm is they're orchestrating and they're signing up and they're getting together to cooperate a scheme against you in the natural. That's why you have to stay prayed and fast up. And we talked about that. The first example was in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. I talked about that. Get a chance, read it. I talked about how they do that in Job chapter 1, verses. This is what we talked about last week. I talked about how Satan challenges God to touch everything that Job has on the earth. And God says everything he has on the earth is under your power. Which was true, because Adam and Eve gave him that power. But he did not have power over their lives. And then we read Job chapter 13, verses 22, how Satan, after discussing what his plans were in the spiritual realm, we talked about how Satan goes about actually performing what he said he was going to do. He does it. And Job ends up losing all of it. When you get a chance in your private time, I want you to go and read those portions of scriptures that I've just given you. Because they have a lot to do with what we're going to do and what we're going to say and talk about tomorrow. God wants you to know that you are a sinner and that you're in need of a Savior. And that acceptance or refusal will determine your destiny. Everybody is appointed to die. I'm in hospice. I'm battling cancer. Okay? But I thank and praise the Lord that he has given me the strength and the fortitude to be able to sit here this morning and talk to you and give you a morning cup of his word. Okay? Because a lot of people are doing a lot of preaching, but they're not preaching God's word. Amen, amen, amen. God's word, because the power is in the word. He said, for the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, cutting, dividing asunder the spirit from the soul, the joint from the marrow, and it is a discerner of the intentions of the heart. I hope I'm quoting that right. Okay? But the point is, God is talking about the power of his word. He said, heaven and earth will pass away. He said, but my word remaineth forever. He even sent his word and healed people in the Bible. And God wants to send his word right now and bring you healing. And this is why I preach the word, because there's power in the word. The Bible says they went forth preaching the word of God, God working with them, confirming the word with signs and wonders following. That's in, I believe, Mark chapter 16. He says this. There's power in the word. That's why this is called a morning cup of word, because I want you to get that word in your spirit. Amen, amen. But one of the things I want you to do is get the word in your heart. Ask the word to come into your life. Ask the word to fill you with the Holy Spirit. Who is the word? Jesus Christ. He is the word made flesh. I want you to ask Jesus to come into your life. So say right after me, Lord Jesus, please come into my life. I admit that I'm a sinner. I admit that I've fallen short of your glory. But Father, I need you in my life. I need you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. I need you to wash me with your blood. I need you to keep me. I need you to change me. I need you not to let me go, Lord God, because I truly, sincerely want to serve you. Please come into my heart. I believe that you raised Jesus from the grave. In Jesus' name, amen. And once you say that, then I want you to go out here and I want you to start confessing it. I don't care what people say you're doing. I don't care if they don't believe it. I want you to go out here and I want you to tell people that you're saved. I don't want you to be intimidated by what other people say or think you are away, because you're gonna find people who believe that you're saved and you are saved. Amen? Amen. Well, I've been your host. My name is Pastor Evangelist Deborah Tate, and you've been listening to A Morning Cup of Word here on Live365.com, Station The Crown Gem. And I will see you tomorrow. And remember Isaiah chapter 62, verse 3. Thou shalt be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Again, I've been your host. Thank you for clicking in and choosing this radio station for your listening pleasure. Selah.